You have been working on a series of stories that have to do with Wyoming game and fish. And a lot of it seems to revolve around how Game and Fish spends money. And I think that this is a great analogy for just about any government agency out there. So what's the latest that you found?
Well, one of the things that we talked a little bit about at the Riverton Freedom Conference on the weekend is how government is like a fungus. I mean, it just grows and grows. And when we look at that, we think, well, how does this happen? I mean, what's the mystery behind that fungal growth? And how do we, you know, put the fungicide on it to stop this from growing, at least those of us who are concerned about out-of-control government and how as government gets bigger, it needs more of your money, and that means you have less money to spend on yourself. And what that ultimately means is you have less ability to make your own choices.
There you go. And, I was about to say, less liberty, less freedom comes with that, not just less money.
No, at the end of the day, that's right. You just have less choice. So with one of the things that I have been working on quite a bit is the Game and Fish Department. And, you know, it seems to be everybody's favorite department. It's the department that people seem to love to hate for whatever reason. And I think part of that is that over time what's happened is that the Game and Fish Department's mandate has crept from the protection, propagation, preservation, and distribution of game animals, birds, and fish of the state to conserving wildlife and serving people, which really, in classic sort of leftist terminology, is something that could mean whatever you want it to mean. And it does. That's sort of what's behind, at the moment, the latest surge in growth in the Game and Fish Department.
Right. So we're talking mission creep, and I think part of the problem, there's always mission creep in any department, but I'm thinking it becomes a whole lot worse when the legislator and any governor signs in to law just these basic outlines that allow them to, well, like EPA is doing right now. Mm-hmm. The water Conservation Act was so broadly written, they could basically take it anywhere, and they are. So they need to write more narrow definitions of what they want these departments to do.
Well, in the case of the EPA, it's a little bit more broad than that. What a lot of these departments have the ability to do is something called rule making.
Mm-hmm.
So the legislators say, you know, we want you to go out and do X. And so what that does is leave in the hands of the bureaucrats the ability to make rules to put into place this X, that whatever it is that the legislators happen to be on at the moment. And that's what has to stop. We need to have legislation that strictly defines what it is these departments do, and then they can, and then that's what they do. They don't start just kind of making stuff up as they go along. And certainly that's what we see, certainly the EPA is particularly bad. But the Game and Fish Department is a really good example of that as well. And the strangest thing that happened, it was like one of these light bulb things going on with Senator Bruce Burns. I'm not exactly sure where he's from, but he's on the Senate Travel, Recreation, Wildlife, and Cultural Resources Committee. And during a House Travel, Recreation, Wildlife, and Cultural Resources Committee meeting in February, Senator Burns came and, in order to sort of protect the ability of the Game and Fish Department to basically do whatever it is it wants to do related to conserving wildlife and serving people, he stood up there and he says, you know, he stands up this committee meeting and he says, you know, I mean, the reason that the Game and Fish Department does what it does is because legislation makes it so. And I just thought, bingo, there it is.
Mm-hmm.
He finally pointed out what was really, really obvious, that the reason the Game and Fish Department does what it does is because legislators are continuously passing legislation, like, you know, you've got to, for instance, protect wolves, you've got to protect bears, you've got to protect this, you've got to protect that. And then what happens is that their mandate grows and grows and people can't understand how come they need more money. Well, they need more, every single time you give them another job, they need more money to do the job because, hey, you need to have more people, you need to have more trucks, you need to have more this, you need to have more that. So inherent in that statement is how we go about shrinking not only the Game and Fish Department, but pretty much any other department as well, and that is by amending the legislation under which it operates. I mean, why didn't I think of that before?
Right. Well, and I've said several times in this program, I don't call those rules and regulations. I call them laws, and my definition of a law is if I have to do it or else, or if I'm caught doing it and I'm punished. So what you've done is given organizations like EPA or Game and Fish the ability to write law. And as soon as they say, we now have the power, they declared the power because the legislative body gave them a power to do A. Well, then if we can do A, then we should be able to do B. And there comes your mission creep again. As soon as they've declared that they have the power to do something, well, obviously we have the power to do the other thing as well, don't we? And so the mission just continues to grow until eventually there's really no way to shut them down except shut down the whole agency.
Yeah, so definitely the first step that legislators have got to take to bring to essentially reel in this Game and Fish out of control, really out of control Game and Fish Department, is start looking at the statute under which it operates, which is Title 23. And the funny thing, you know, I go up to the legislature all the time, and I'm always hearing these bureaucrats, and they're testifying before these different committees. And every once in a while, they seem to know who I am for some reason. I can't imagine why.
I have no idea.
Yeah, and they come up to me later and they'll say things like, you know, the reason we do this is because it's in legislation. And I say, you know, and in fact, I would say to them, I guess that means we need to change the legislation.
Mm-hmm.
And I get a deer in the headlights look
yeah.
from them.
Yeah.
It's fear. What do you mean? What do you mean? So Title 23 has a whole, I mean, it's a great, huge piece of legislation, and in there are a bunch of different things that enable or empower, basically, the Game and Fish Department to do all kinds of things. A lot of the things, for instance, really are something that the private sector should be doing, and that, for instance, is in 23.1.302, the Game and Fish Department is empowered to acquire lands and waters in the name of Wyoming by purchase lease agreement. Gift or devise, not including the powers of eminent domain, so they can't just take your stuff, which is like a bonus, I guess. And to develop, improve, operate, and maintain fish hatcheries, rearing ponds, game farms, and bird farms. In other words, it's this legislation that has given Game and Fish the job of raising fish and birds. And this is something that should be done in the private sector. And so what we need to see the legislators do, and I hope listeners are, you know, calling in to the legislators to let them know that, look, we need to reel in this Game and Fish Department, and in order to do that, we need to amend this legislation. What we need to do is repeal that language, and if we repeal that language, then the Game and Fish Department would be out of the hatchery and bird farm business. That's the first step to reeling in the mandate of this agency.
Have they taken any steps that would cause any problems? I get a complaint every so often from people who are hunters, fishermen, et cetera, in the permitting process. I mean, have they made that process easier or harder? Because I seem to be hearing from people who call me and email me from time to time that getting a permit to go out and recreate in Wyoming is getting harder and harder and more expensive.
Yeah, they've been prevented from raising hunting and fishing license fees. But I got a call from someone else. I haven't actually checked into this, but apparently there's a fee to get your license online. So in other words, you have to pay an additional fee to get your license. So that's a license fee increase. I mean, it doesn't really matter what you call it. It's still costing more for a person to get a hunting or fishing license. That's a fee increase. They've been prevented from doing that, and yet they're sneaking around the back door basically and saying, well, you know, this is not for the license. This is in order to go online. But I mean, supposedly the reason they've moved, I mean, all kinds of departments have moved from having a personal service to online services because it's supposed to be cheaper, not as a way to sort of extract even more funds out of the pockets of hunters and fishermen.
Okay, well, so if they're having to pay for fees, what about just access to Wyoming lands? I mean, has Game and Fish made that easier or harder?
Well, that's a whole bigger question. That's sort of part of the reason that the Game and Fish Department likes to sort of stay in the game and instead of doing what a number of other states have been doing, and that's trying to partner with private landowners, is because of this whole worry that some of the smaller or individual hunters have about access. So the Game and Fish Department will tell you that the way they've got this access set up currently is better, because what a lot of people worry about is that, as has happened in other states, the private landowner is given is encouraged to actually look at wildlife as a resource instead of as a problem. Mm. And then what that, you know, so it becomes just sort of like another, in a sense, like another farm animal in a way that they're able to generate revenue from. And so they can actually sell, in a sense, they can actually sell licenses to private hunters to go onto their land and then hunt privately. Mm. But we don't exactly have that here in Wyoming, because there's been a real resistance by bureaucrats at the Game and Fish Department to bring on the private sector, or, you know, private landowners as partners. They see more like a, it's more like sort of a, almost like the enemy instead of someone that you should actually work with, because of course the Game and Fish Department doesn't want to lose any of their power. And if they empower landowners to look at animals like a resource, then the Game and Fish Department themselves would lose their power, and then of course the they could actually get smaller, which would mean they'd have fewer employees, and I mean the whole empire building situation would sort of fall apart, and that's of course something that they don't want to see.
Isn't this the same department that you told me had two separate budgets?
Yeah, so the Game and Fish Department, like the Department of Transportation, have got it's their off-budget budget, right? Mm. So what happened a couple of years ago is that Representative Sue Wallace, who unfortunately has passed away, brought forward, she's from Gillette, I guess. She brought forward a piece of legislation that would bring that off-budget back under the purview of the Appropriations Committee. And that sort of happened. So last session, just last February, that it was the first year that had happened, that the Wyoming Department of Transportation and the Game and Fish Department budgets were looked at in their entirety. Not that it did any good, because I mean, one of the other things that the Game and Fish Department has been busily trying to do is offload the costs from their off-budget onto the general taxpayer. So essentially, so there's the commission budget and the general fund budget. The general fund budget is the budget that the legislators would actually look at. But the commission budget was one until just recently the legislators didn't look at. That commission budget is vastly larger. Anyway, well, it was maybe 10 times larger. That's shrinking down, because essentially what the Game and Fish Department is busily trying to do, and this is all part of this conservation push, which is backed by the AFL-CIO and a bunch of environmental groups, they're trying to offload the costs from hunters and fishermen or hunters and anglers, because they can't get their fees increased anymore. I mean, they can't squeeze any more money out of these people. And you've got to remember that hunting and fishing is competitive. So if someone's coming from someplace like Florida to hunt elk, they can do it here in Wyoming, or they could do it someplace else. I mean, driving from Wyoming, from Florida to Wyoming or Montana, is not that big of a difference. And if there's a huge discrepancy in license fee cost, then the person might tend to go to Montana instead. So what the Game and Fish Department is trying to do, of course it still feels like it needs more money, is it's working to offload a lot of some of the costs, we've just seen the beginning of that, I'm sure, from the commission budget onto the general fund budget. The general fund budget, it just has a few things, and this kind of goes back to this thing we talked about before, where what the legislators do is say, oh, you know, you need to do this, you need to do that. And so wolf conservation was something that has been on the general fund budget for I think since about 2009 or so, the last time I checked. And this is actually kind of interesting, because this is another thing that's inside the statutes that could be amended or repealed, and it says basically that the Game and Fish Commission shall, by rule and regulation, set seasons and bag limits within those areas where gray wolves are designated as trophy game animals. So basically what that means is that the Game and Fish Department manages wolves only within the wolf trophy game management area, which is a very small part of the state, just around Yellowstone National Park up in the northwest corner of the state. So now the Game and Fish does monitor wolves statewide, because, I mean, remember, it was back in 2012 that wolves were delisted. So what's happened since wolves got delisted? Well, it cost the Game and Fish Department $475,000 roughly to manage wolves during the 2009-10 biennium, about $741,000 in the 11-12 biennium, and that dropped down to about $608,000 during the 13-14 biennium. And the drop, according to the Game and Fish Department, was because, well, you know, gee, their effort wasn't adequately funded.
Yeah.
So if you stop to think about that one for a minute, you're saying, okay, the Game and Fish Department only spent $600,000 because the legislature didn't give them any more money to spend.
You will watch a grown man faint right in front of you if any of these departments ever ask for less money and less power. I'm talking a lot of numbers here, a lot of details, but if you look at, because you kind of piqued my interest when you said some groups that are behind, let's call it pushing Game and Fish to get done some of what they're trying to get done. I mean, are there environmentalist groups and other such organizations outside of the state of Wyoming trying to push Game and Fish in Wyoming?
Well, if you go to any of these TRW committee meetings, what you'll find are different groups. we find me saying they should spend less, and then you'll find all these other groups saying that they should be spending more. And some of those groups include groups like the AFL-CIO, which, of course, is a big union. And then there are always these environmental groups there, and one is the Nature Conservancy, and another is something called the Wyoming Wildlife Federation. And it's not like the Game and Fish Department needs to be pushed to spend more. I mean, really. They'll do it on their own, but it's even better if they've got groups there who are testifying before these legislators saying, geez, you know, if the Game and Fish Department doesn't spend more, then, wolves could be relisted.
See, it reminds me of when Amy Edmonds was on this show saying that she went to a school board meeting and found a lot of special interest groups, people who didn't even live in Wyoming.
Yeah, the Climate Parents, that's the Climate Parents, is a group from California who are here in Wyoming, and they're trying to say, you know, gee, we need to have global warming indoctrination in schools. Right. I mean, what we're saying is that, no, we shouldn't have global warming. Excuse me, we should not have global warming. Any kind of indoctrination, in particular, not global warming indoctrination. But if you look at what happened for the 2015-2016 biennium budget, when it comes to wolf management, it went from that $608,000 that I mentioned from the last biennium to almost $1.5 million.
Wow.
And if you look at who's behind this, you'll see that what we've got are these groups out there saying, look, you know, if you guys don't spend more, wolves will be relisted. So they've essentially scared legislators into giving more money to the Game and Fish Department.
Maureen, as always, great having you on. Enjoy the rest of the day off. Go play.
Well, thanks, Ben. All right, bye.